basketball One Fighting Championship Warriors Way. A light heavyweight contest between NCAA Division I wrestler from the United States, Jake Butler, going head-to-head with French judo champion Sylvain Poutin. Then, in the main event of the evening for the ONE FC Bantamweight Championship of the World, from South Korea, Dae Hwan Kim taking on the champion from Brazil, Bibiano Fernandes.
You know, I'm gonna show the Filipino fight fans in the motherland a show that they never expected before. I'll make sure that they understand who I am and what I came here to do and represent the Philippines in ONE FC.
I know he's been around for many, many years, but it doesn't matter to me. I feel very comfortable and confident.
Bibiano, 너가 주짓수 파이터면 내가 너를 주짓수로 피니시 시켜주겠어.
I think it's good, but let's see. You know what I mean? He think he beat me, please. Bring your best. That's what I ask you. Because if you don't do your best, I will do it. Manila, let's do it.
We're back in the Philippines, in the capital city of Manila, the Mall of Asia Arena, hosting One Fighting Championship again, and there's big action coming up. You know, it seemed for a while there as if Jake Butler was just storming his way towards the light heavyweight title here at One Fighting Championship. Then he met a man called Sylvain Poutard, who blew him away with a fantastic left cross. Tonight is the rematch.
Butler's made it very clear that the last time was a fluke. Okay, I had a chance to talk to him. He said he's worked more on his wrestling for this fight. He's gonna come out here and try and get the takedown. Poutard, though, has made sure that he's made it very clear as well that this was not a fluke. He's had more time to prepare for this fight. He's gonna look to kind of come in and do the same thing. Land that straight left, possibly use his judo to stop the takedown, reverse the takedown, and get on top and ground and pound him out.
If you're unfamiliar with our rules here at One Fighting Championship, here's a quick reminder. We have a global MMA rule set. Each bout is 3 5-minute rounds, unless it's a championship contest, in which case it's 5 5-minute rounds. Stomps to the head of a downed opponent are illegal.
But what fans have to remember is that the soccer kick to the head is legal, as well as knees to the head and elbows to the head to a downed opponent.
If it goes this far, then the judges will score the bout based on the following items and in this order: near KO or submission, damage inflicted, striking superiority in ground control, takedown and takedown defense, and aggression.
What fans have to remember is the fights here at ONE FC are graded in its entirety, so it is not a round-by-round basis grading system.
The first fight with Sylvain obviously didn't go the way that I had hoped it would. I was in control of the fight. It was my fight to win. And in the second round, I got a little careless. I made some mental mistakes, and I paid for them. I've since made the adjustments, and this time out, it's going to be a lot different.
Mon dernier combat avec Jake Butler, bah écoute, il s'est passé comme ce que j'avais prévu. C'est-à-dire, il a voulu boxer avec moi. On a boxé et à la finalité, il a perdu. Bon, écoute, il a voulu faire une revanche. Le ONE FC, ils m'ont proposé un deuxième combat, donc je peux pas refuser. Et il n'y a pas de souci, on va se remettre dessus.
This time the rules will be reversed. I'm going to come out. We got lucky the first time with the knockout, and I don't see it happening again. I'm prepared, and you know, I'm not going to give him the opportunity.
Here's how they're stuck up then, side to side. Both men in their early 30s. Poutin is the older man by 2 years. Quite a big height difference. Jake Butler is enormous. At 1.9 meters, 10 centimeters taller than Poutin. This is the United States of America against France.
Ladies and gentlemen, and fight fans from all around the world, welcome to the Mall of Asia Arena. This is One Fighting Championship Warriors Way. We are now live globally, so get ready for a night of nonstop MMA action. This first fight is 3 rounds of 5 minutes in the 1FC light heavyweight division. And it's brought to you by Resorts World Manila. Nothing compares. Introducing first, fighting out of the blue corner, this man is a wrestler, standing at 190 centimeters tall, weighing in at 92.7 kilograms, with a professional record of 4 wins and 1 loss. Fighting out of Evolve MMA, NCAA Division I wrestler, Jake Butler! And now introducing his opponent, fighting out of the red corner, he is a judo fighter, standing at 180 centimeters tall, weighing in at 92.7 kilograms, with a professional MMA record of 7 wins, 4 losses. Fighting out of Crossfight, he is the French judo champion, Sylvain the Punisher Potard! And when the action begins, your referee in charge, Yuji Shimada.
5 minutes, 3 rounds, no headbutting, not a growing, no less offense. On the ground, do not stomp the face, okay? Clean fight, touch gloves.
This fight brought to you by Resorts World Manila, nothing compares. And really nothing compares to a good old-fashioned rematch. And this one's got grudge written all over it. Sylvain Potard's not even sure why he's there. He won it cleanly, fairly, squarely, emphatically, he thinks. Jake Butler has other ideas.
Looks to be a little bit of a size difference. Jake Butler looks extremely tall.
He is a big light heavyweight.
Standing next to Potard.
Oh!
Nice takedown. Able to go right to passing the guard. Setting in a little bit of a guillotine. He's got control, chin control.
Butler looking for a knee to the head there, which the size of those knees would cause some considerable damage. And Potard's right hand is there to block it. He doesn't want that happening at all.
Butler's got his right knee to the hip, keeping him from bellying down, as well as the right arm on the inside of between his legs.
I can tell you all Potard is worried about is stopping that left knee coming into contact with his forehead. And I don't blame him.
What Butler's doing really well, notice how he's got the chin control. It's really keeping his face exposed so he can knee to the face. He's got a nice side mount or side control here, dropping the elbows to the sides of the thighs.
Potard grabs that left leg of Butler to try and prevent that knee from coming in. It's too close now to cause any damage, but there's space again, and if Butler chooses to.
Butler looks like he's gonna probably try and shuck him down. He's working on that front guillotine. What I mean by shuck him down, he's gonna snap his forehead back down to the mat. He's clenching the legs, keeping him from using his feet to stand back up. He's gonna wall walk, so Potard's looking to put his back against the fence like he just did right there and start to wall walk up.
Still looking for that knee to the head, and again Potard blocked it. So good defensive work from Potard to prevent what was, for a time there, a real threat.
It's a lot of work though to get back up. Notice how Butler keeps trying to grab that wrist control on the left side so he can work the knees on the clinch there, as well as trying to drop down on a single leg and get the takedown. There you go, you saw the knee right there.
Butler works with world champions in the Evolve MMA gym day in, day out. Muay Thai world champions, Jiu-Jitsu world champions. He is himself a wrestler of a very high pedigree.
He was the captain of the Princeton University wrestling team. He's been over here at Evolve, just training with all the other world champions there.
But as Sylvain Potard would say, none of that matters if you can connect with a solid left cross to the chin.
Well, he's already proven that matters. He's looking to do it again here tonight. You can already tell a little bit with Butler. He's stepping off to the left side, staying away from Petard's power hand. So when he throws punches, Butler is going to step off to the left when he throws this straight right to avoid Petard's straight left in this power hand.
Just a little bit out of range, Butler, with his punches. Potard's moving out of range.
He looks like he has a reach advantage, so he's trying to keep right on the end of his punch. There he goes, punch to the clinch. He's just trying to close that distance, so he's staying outside the range, outside of Pitar's range. As he throws punches, he steps in, he tries to get to the clinch.
That's new.
What Jake Butler needs to do is he needs to put his chin, put his forehead underneath his chin of Pitard, try and get that body control so his body lock is a little bit better. He's able to pull him off the fence. Look for Pitard to use his judo possibly here to turn him and possibly get a throw.
He's really got that judo upper body, hasn't he, Pitard? Just packed with muscle, huge across the shoulders.
I've trained with a lot of world champions in judo, and man, one thing they are is extremely strong and explosive.
He seems wary of Butler's punch, though, ironically, given that it was Potard's punch that ended their first fight.
I think he's more just concerned of the punch landing as well as getting in the takedown. So he just doesn't want to get caught with something small real quick to end up in this position where he just ended up. What you'll notice with Jake is that the punches really are just a setup to get into the clinch and get to the takedown.
Well, their first fight went into the second round and finished fairly early on in that second round. This one will go into a second as well.
Hooray!
It's round two when we come back. Welcome back to the Mall of Asia Arena in Manila, the Philippines, for ONE Fighting Championship Warriors Way. Stand by for Jake Butler against Silvan Potar. Just let me remind you, we don't score contests round by round. So that's not like Butler's won the first round and there's two to go. What it means is he's ahead in the fight so far. We score the fight in its entirety. Three judges will do that for us at cage side. Rich Franklin is here to give you the best indication you can possibly get of how things are going from a non-judge's perspective. Still quite a lot of smoke in the air from the pyrotechnics that we had when the fighters were announced. From our position here, looking up into the bright lights in the ceiling, that's quite clear. Not bothering these guys, though.
Jake with a nice shot, gets in, got the single leg, able to shuck him down. Pitard's going to start to use his back against the fence. Notice how he's got his knee in between his legs. Jake just hipped in beautifully. Got him, I believe he's got him in full mount there. Pushing on the face. Look for him to start laying some elbows in there.
Yeah, you can tell he's going to look for those elbows as soon as he can position himself.
Big punches.
Got his back.
Pitard's going to probably use the fence a little bit to try and bridge and mount him off. Not really landed in big strikes just yet.
Nonetheless, this is a troublesome time for Potard.
He needs to start pushing on the hips, trying to get away, start to get that amount of escape. There he goes.
National judo champion in France.
He's got someone's bleeding a little bit.
Hard to tell exactly who's bleeding. I suspect it's Potard, given the punishment he's taking.
Looks like he's going right, trying to get back to mount. Oh, the ear is bleeding just
a
little
bit.
Yeah,
that's right. Pitard's left ear.
Got him flat now. He's laying in some big punches now.
Big left hands coming down. I wonder if he'll switch it up to elbows and forearms. The punches are pretty accurate there. Two hands now. Started off with the left. Both of them are coming in. There's nothing coming back from Pitard. Is he going to be able to reply or defend himself intelligently? That's what the referee will be looking for.
Going back to that chin control, he's trying to open up the chin so he can get the arm underneath the chin for the rear naked choke. You can tell Jake's got really good hips. Pitard's having a real hard time escaping this mount position.
Using his weight very, very effectively to keep his man where he wants him. Jake Butler, with all that experience from collegiate wrestling.
Notice how Jake isn't so high up on the body. He's keeping his hips down low by the legs, kind of keeping the pressure on his legs, so it's harder for Pitard to actually move left to right. Pitard's going to look to start to get up. Good chin control again. He's working on that chin control so he can start opening that face up for a knee to the face.
That's exactly what I was going to say. That face is exposed to the knee again. And it's important for Potar that he gets that hand in between forehead and knee.
Got that guillotine in. Oh, lost it. I think Jake needs to put a hook in. There he goes. He's trying to put that hook in a little bit. Get a little bit more control of the hips. He's got the two on. He's got wrist control on the far side. He's keeping that arm so he can't really defend properly. Potar can't defend. So Jake's hitting him with some little shots right now. This isn't going to really stop the fight, I don't believe. Jake needs to kind of just open up and let it go.
We're looking at 15, 16 punches coming in without reply. And that defense, no matter how hard he tries, is a porous one. And Yudi Shimada is standing over them, watching very carefully as Potard bleeds now from the mouth. Thought he had a chance to get up there, but not with Jake Butler's weight on top of him. That'll take a big effort.
Notice how Potard's putting his back to the fence. Trying to wall walk again. We call that wall walking or cage walking to try and get your back up against the fence. The pressure that Jake puts into him gives him the ability to get up.
Back on his feet, but this has been a world of pain for Sylvain Potard. A round that he did not want to go through. 1 minute left now. 1 minute
left. This is where you expect to see Potard use his judo to kind of get him off the fence. He looks a little tired, though. He said he worked his conditioning, a lot of conditioning for this fight. I've yet to see it, though. It looks like he's getting a little bit tired.
Butler goes for something new, the single leg, to get back down there. It's the last thing Potard wants.
There he goes, digging that underhook, that right side underhook. He's trying to elevate that Butler's shoulder so he can scoot off the fence.
30 seconds.
This fight has gone on quite a bit longer than their first round did, their first contest, I should say. It finished after 42 seconds of the second round, first time around. It looks very much as we're going to move into a third round. Final 10 seconds.
Potard looking up at the clock to see how much time. That generally shows that someone's getting a little bit tired.
I think they're both a little bit tired and will be very, very happy to take this minute's rest.
Little touch of gloves as they pass by.
Some of the action from the second round, Josh.
Jake's hipped into him right here, so Potard's having a hard time getting his back to the fence. Here you go with Jake laying down big punches. I'd really like to see Jake open it up with more than just this. See, he's just throwing one punch, and they're not really that hard. He needs to actually make a little bit of space or just throw a little bit harder with both hands or just with that one.
5 minutes left for Sylvain Potard to make something of this contest. And this whole point about us not scoring round by round, if we did, then Jake Butler would be two rounds up. And really, there's no way back for Potard without a stoppage. But that's not how we do it at ONE FC. You look at the fight in its entirety, and Potard has every chance to get back in this now if he can do something special.
Let's touch back on Rich here a little bit. What exactly does Potard need to do to actually get the win? Just in this round, besides knock him out.
Well, he's going to have to inflict a ton of damage, possibly a near finish. On our scoring criteria, the near finish is the highest of the hierarchy. So if he clipped Jake, nearly knocked him out, and then on top of it did a bunch of damage in the round, he could run away with this fight.
And that's why it's so exciting to go into a third round, even though one fighter looks to have taken the previous two rounds in isolation.
You have to remember that the scoring in these fights are designed to make the fighters actually finish the fight. That's the objective. So if Potard in this third round could possibly come close to finishing this fight, and decisively so, then that would definitely supersede everything that Butler did in the first two rounds.
Great point. It means that Butler cannot afford to coast in this round with the cushion of a potential victory. Makes it fun for the fans, makes it fun for you guys at home. Not so much fun for the fighters, perhaps.
Just another thing to touch base on that. The first round usually is very close. Nice body kick by Jake. The first round's usually pretty close. So the second round was a runaway by Jake. So the first round, you could actually say, lean a little bit more towards Jake, but then going into the third, if Potard was actually to run away with it, that's kind of how they're judging this.
Less than 3.5 minutes now for the Frenchman to do something special.
Jake's got him pressed up against the fence and a nice little clinch. Look for him to continue. He's looking to control that wrist there. Continue that wrist control, trying to open up the knees to the body.
Well, if Sylvain Potard asked Josh Thompson, why are we doing this? What's the reason for a rematch? Then Jake Butler, as we stand, is providing the answer.
We're seeing the exact reason. You know, and I think Jake looks really good. You know, he needs to just open up his stand-up just a little bit more. I think Potard's getting hit to the game, just the one punch in the shot, one punch in the shot. But let's see if he can actually look to finish. You see? He needed to open it up a little bit more, sell it, feign it. Now he's in a position where he could potentially end the fight where it was last time. He shot a bad shot last fight, end up in this position, and when he rocked back, he hit him with a beautiful shot.
And now Potard's knees are causing a threat to Jake Butler's head, and that's why he's got both hands out there trying to prevent that connection.
Drove him to the fence. It's a perfect place for Jake to be because this is where the least amount of damage can be done.
Takes away the leverage to throw those knees.
Potard needs to open up and open up Jake's arms, get him off the leg and make space and get away.
Entering the final 2 minutes.
2 minutes left, Mark Sham.
This contest, Butler's for the taking.
Potard needs to circle off that fence, try and get Butler to shoot another bad shot like that.
And Yuji Shimada, who is an absolute stickler for action, separates them, puts them back in the center of the cage and says, get it on with a minute and a half left.
This definitely favors Potard in this situation. You know, every time they break, it's forcing Jake to take another bad shot. I think Potard needs to, there you go again. Potard needs to keep his legs away. Maybe snap his head back down so he starts to knee the head again.
Deja vu, isn't it? He avoided the single leg takedown, gets hold of Jake Butler's head, and potentially can damage him with those knees. Although once more, Butler pulls him in to take that leverage, that space that you need to do that away. Final minute.
1 minute left
in the final round. Yuji Shimada says, stop clinching the cage. That's illegal. You can put your hands or your feet on the cage. You can walk along it, but you can't grip it with your fingers or your toes.
It's going to be hard for Potard to win this fight doing that, but what I was trying to say was it's going to be hard for him to win the fight by staying in the clinch. We've got 40 seconds left. He needs to really make something happen.
It's going to be tough now. Final half minute.
30 seconds left to go.
It's hard for two big men to work their way through 15 minutes of grueling effort, dealing with each other's body weight and everything you can press against your opponent. And you can see the effects of that now. Both fighters pretty gassed, and it's going to be too little too late there for Sylvain Potard. Jake Butler, we feel fairly confident at cage side here, has won a rematch.
I was actually surprised to see that Potard didn't use more of his judo and then, until the very end when he was tired and slippery. It sounded like when I talked to him earlier this week that he was going to use it.
Just before the decision is made and as we look at these highlights from the fight, let's just go to Rich and get Rich. I assume you've got Jake Butler ahead.
Yeah, I do have Jake Butler winning this fight. If we were scoring round by round, that round would go to Potard, in my opinion. He had several good takedown defenses. You could argue that he actually scored on a damage inflicted by landing those knees. It's arguable. But Jake did so much in the first two rounds of this fight that he accumulated too many points for Potard to even possibly catch up on with the performance of the third round. So overall, I'm going to award this to Jake. I'm assuming that the judges will as well.
Ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds, we go to the judges' scorecards. And all three judges see it for your winner via unanimous decision. From the blue corner, Jake Butler!
So, Evolve have their light heavyweight star from the United States back on track and looking in the direction of a title fight. Bibiano Fernandes against Dae Hwan Kim next. Welcome back to the Mall of Asia Arena in Manila, the Philippines, for ONE Fighting Championship Warriors Way. Dae Hwan Kim against Bibiano Fernandes for the bantamweight strap. And Josh, this is a fight where Bibiano, who's impressed everyone every time he's come into the ONE FC cage, could really get his bell rung.
He's one of the best right now in the world. He's been one of the best in the last 2 years. And honestly, I don't see how Kim's gonna win this fight. But I gotta say, Kim's looked very impressive the last two fights with submissions. He's came in with an attitude. We saw it heat up yesterday at the weigh-ins, and this is gonna be a great fight.
This is the main event of the evening. It is five rounds for the ONE FC Bantamweight World Championship.
I feel very confident for the fight. I train good, I train strong. He's a very special kid, and he wants to win so badly, but I don't care about what he doing, what he training. For me, it doesn't matter. What's matter for me, what I do, what the way I train. For me, it's matter, the day the fight there, I hope I can be my best there, that's gonna be good for me.
제 이제 MMA 선수로서 최종 목표는 세계 챔피언 타이틀 두 체격을 석권하는 거기 때문에 그 중간 과정이라고 뭐 치고 차고 주먹 발 그리고 니킥 엘보 다 강하기 때문에 뭐 딱히 어떤 게 강하다고 생각하지 않고 모든 게 다 강하다고 생각합니다. 기본적으로 스탠딩으로 싸우고 스탠딩에서 KO를 시킬 생각을 하고 있고요. 옛말에 위에는 이 눈에는 이런 말이 있지. 뭐 비비아노 너가 주짓수 파이터면 내가 너를 주짓수로 피니시 시켜줄게.
For me, I go knock out Bibiano, I go beat up Bibiano. But when the fight begins, it's different.
Bibiano가 그라운드 이제 뭐 세계 챔피언을 세 번 했는데 뭐 저 거기에 저는 익숙되지 않고 저도 뭐 그라운드면 그라운드, 타격이면 타격. 뭐 하나에 집착하지 않고 주눅 들지 않고 뭐든지 그냥.
I don't think he fight anyone in my skill. My skill level. He's good, yes, but definitely not fight nobody in my level.
Bibiano가 저를 이기는 것은 불가능합니다.
You think he beat me, and I know I go beat you.
Is he ready for it? Let's find out. He's 3 centimeters taller, the champion. 7 years older. For the bantamweight championship of the world, this is Korea against Brazil.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is the main event of the evening. This is 5 rounds, 5 minutes for the ONE FC Bantamweight World Championship. And it's brought to you by Patron, fuel for everyone. Our three judges scoring this fight at cage side are Joey Lipitan from the Philippines, Joel Bowen from the United States, and Rosenberg Rossetti from the Philippines. Manila, let's witness a battle! Introducing first, fighting out of the blue corner. This man is just a striker, standing at 167 centimeters tall, weighing in at 61 kilograms, holding a professional MMA record of 10 wins and 1 draw. Fighting out of Rayong Promotion, Cook J Gym, the challenger, Kama Bantamweight Champion from South Korea, Otogi Dae Hwan Kim. And now introducing his opponent, fighting out of the red corner. This man is a boxer and a BJJ practitioner, standing at 170 centimeters tall, weighing in at 61 kilograms, holding a professional MMA record of 16 wins, 3 losses. Fighting out of AMC Pancration, presenting the reigning, defending ONE FC Bantamweight World Champion from Brazil, Bibiano, the Flash. And when this battle begins, your referee in charge, Yuji Shimada.
This
this is a title shot, okay? No head butting, no growing, no blood fence, on the ground, no slump to face. Okay? Aggressive fight, touch gloves. Come on. Judge.
That's Dae Hwan Kim.
You ready?
And that's Bibiano Fernandez. This fight brought to you by Petron, fuel for everyone. Bantamweight championship on the line. The champion in the black trunks, the challenger in the red and white.
What I noticed yesterday when I was watching, when I had a chance to talk to both of them, that Bibiano looks significantly bigger than Kim, body-wise.
No attack back.
Look at Bibiano looking to press him against the fence. He looked like he's locking his hands right now. There you go, right down.
No, no spine line. Kim.
It's a quick and purposeful start from the Brazilian.
Bibiano needs to gather both legs. You see him trying to gather both legs with his left leg there. If he gathers both legs, he could possibly turn his back off the fence and go right to mount. See how his left arm is real deep underneath both legs? If he takes his left leg and then steps over, he looks like he's losing the position now.
No, spine line.
I was wondering what Kim was going to do there. He seemed to have time and space to do something. He decided to just dig some elbows into the shoulder blade. Yuji Shimada doesn't want to see any more of that because he's worried about hitting the back of the head. What do you think about that, Rich?
Many times.
Well, Dae Hwan is obviously targeting the spine with the elbows and the back of the head with the elbows. We have trouble seeing the angle from here, but Yuji's right on top of it. I'm sure he probably gave Dae Hwan Kim a verbal warning there and then decided to yellow card him. At this point in time, that means that Kim is going to lose 10% of his purse.
Here's the replay. Yeah, that's the back of the neck. That's the shoulder blade.
He let him get away with it one time. Gave him a little, it looked like a verbal warning. Okay. And then he hit him again two more times. One was like a real slight one, but.
There did seem to be one solidly in the back of the neck, Rich.
You have to remember that from this replay that there were several elbows that were thrown prior to that replay as well. So we don't know if Yuji actually gave Dae Hwan a warning prior to that, verbally.
And I've noticed that they're restarting him in the same position.
Absolutely. Just because there was a foul doesn't mean that it has to change the direction of the fight. Bibiano at this point in time has actually earned this takedown, so you don't want to take that away from him and start the fight back on the feet.
Yeah, you'll find that in other organizations, they actually start him standing up after the foul. Bibiano gets reversed here when he went for the back. Beautiful work into the triangle. If he can lock it in. Switching to the armbar.
The armbar was on right from the beginning there.
Kim's out, but Bibiano is pre-attacking right now. That's nice work. Kim pulls out.
Yeah, good. Yes, Tachia, okay.
Kim hitting him with a little short chopping shots to the side of the head.
Better make sure he doesn't get him on the back of the head.
Bibiano stands back up. Gonna look to try and turn it. There you go, turn it facing. To me, I think you can see the size and I think a little bit of the strength difference though between the two when Bibiano took him down as well as he's able to control the top position for a little bit. With Kim, he's just real scrappy. He moves real well on the bottom. He scrambles really well. His scramble, I think, is going to make the difference in this fight if he gets the win tonight. They've kind of both really put out a lot of energy in that first little exchange. Now they're back on their feet, probably catching their breath a little bit, getting ready to go at it again. Remember, this is a 5-round fight, so they've got plenty of time.
Yeah, much longer fight than the 3-round version. 10 minutes longer, flying knee from Kim, taken to the ground by Bibiano.
Bibiano right to the clinch, right to the takedown, hits him with a big
left
shot.
Left and right. Little bit wild.
Kim smiles. That's almost to say as if you got me with a good one.
Doesn't always mean you're happy.
Bibiano, the looping left hook just missed. Kim with the spinning back kick. Oh!
And another one, the knee connected to the head that time. Bibiano ducked into it, I think.
Yeah, sometimes when people, they throw a spinning back fist, they don't know how to react, so they actually just cover up and they duck their head at the same time, bringing their elbows into their body. I think he just caught him off guard. He wasn't expected to back-to-back. moving around right now, kind of getting a feel for each other.
Nice little jab from Bibiano.
You tell what the game plan is, though, from Bibiano. He wants to come in here, get to the clinch, get to the takedown. Wants to show he has top position.
Beautiful double leg. There's a nice takedown.
That was a beautiful double leg. He waited for Kim to step in. He shot in on the double leg and was able to lift and elevate it for the slam.
Busy work from the Brazilian, punching to the side, and one or two to the head there. Running out of time to do anything significant from this position in the first round. We're going into a second five-round contest with a championship belt at stake. 25 minutes, potentially, of this kind of action, Josh.
Bibiano had a great transition right here to the triangle. Then he felt like he was losing it. You notice right here, he starts to go to the armbar. You see the pressure he's putting on the armbar. Kim was able to wiggle out of it. Then Kim jumped for a flying knee, missed. Bibiano was able to get to the body lock and take him down, but wasn't able to control top position. This is where Kim shined. He threw a spinning back kick, and then he threw it. He doubled up on it, which will almost always throw people off.
It's round two when we come back. Welcome back to the Mall of Asia Arena in Manila, the Philippines, for One Fighting Championship Warriors Way. This is Dae Hwan Kim against Bibiano Fernandes. Here's the action from round two.
Round two.
Fascinating first round. We've got four more to come, potentially. And Bibiano Fernandes knows he's in a contest, even though he may well have the edge at this juncture. Don't forget, these five rounds will end up with a fight that the judges score in its entirety, not round by round. Furious scramble.
Kim's scramble was just unbelievable. I mean, he dropped his hips so fast. Bibiano was in real deep on that double leg, and then he had to switch to the single leg and wasn't able to get the takedown. I think in situations like this where I feel like, oh, beautiful spinning back kick.
Very nicely done. Yeah, right in the belly.
I think in situations like this, Bibiano needs to actually pressure him against the fence. Beautiful back kick from the standing position. That was a great back take.
We're looking to see if that left arm is under the throat.
There it is, he sinks it in.
That is under, right under. And this could
the
be
it. It's over.
It's over. Bibiano Fernandes has retained his bantamweight championship. His wife there in the crowd is as delighted as many of his fans are. Another successful defense against an opponent who at times looked as if he was going to cause him quite a few problems. As always, the two combatants embrace mid-cage. Here's how it finished. He got up on his back. The extent of the arm around the throat at that point was hard for us to see. Was it under the chin there, or was it cranking the chin inwards? There, it was quite conclusive, wasn't it? Right around the throat, and the tap, well, it was just a matter of time. The Brazilian owns that belt for a few more months at least. Pound for pound, the best around.
Ladies and gentlemen, referee Yuji Shimada calls hold to this battle at a minute 16 seconds of round number two. For your winner, by submission via rear naked choke, and still ONE FC bantamweight world champion, Bibiano the Flesh Fernandes.
How wonderful to see that respect from the two, as we so often do. Congratulations from the CEO of One Fighting Championship, Victor Gui. Bibiano Fernandes does it again.
in a shower of ticker tape that has flooded the cage and indeed all of my notes here at cage side. But it's all about Bibby. Who dares take on this man next time? What great entertainment we've had here at the Mall of Asia Arena in Manila. Join us next time, won't you, for more breathtaking fights at ONE Fighting Championship.